أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على خير خلقه العبد المؤيد والرسول المسدد حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وصحابته المنتجبين صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة ويا عبرة كل مؤمن ومؤمنة يا مظلوم يا غريب يا شهيد كربلاء يا ليتنا يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم عبس وتولى أن جاءه الأعمى وما يدريك لعله يزكى أو يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى صلى على محمد وآل محمد A second for the love of Imams al-Hasan and al-Husayn. A third for the love of Fatima al-Zahra with your loudest voices. The first few verses in the chapter of Abbas or Abasa wa Tawalla tell us of a story of a person who frowned and turned away when the blind man came to him. He frowned and turned away when the blind man came to him. And then, first, the verse is speaking in third person. The person is not there. He frowned and he turned away when the blind man came to him. And then the Quran starts speaking to that person directly, first person. And how do you know that this person will not become righteous? Or perhaps he will be reminded and the reminder will benefit him. The verses are obviously scolding someone. Someone is being lectured. Someone is being lectured by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these verses. Who is that person that looked away and frowned? Who is that person that was approached by a blind man and he ignored that blind man? He humiliated him, he insulted him. And rather, he looked to the rich men that were sitting next to him. أَمَّا مَنْ اسْتَغْنَى فَأَنْتَ لَهُ تَصَدَّى. As for the rich people, you give your attention to them. وَأَمَّا مَنْ جَاءَكَ يَسْعَى فَأَنْتَ عَنْهُ وَأَمَّا مَنْ جَاءَكَ يَسْعَى فَأَنْتَ عَنْهُ تَلَهَى. As for the one that comes to you, the one who is poor, the one who is not rich like the others, you turn away from and you ignore. Who are these verses speaking about? According to the Sunni school of thought and Sunni exegesis, Mufassireen, they believe that these verses are speaking about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Rasulullah is being addressed in these verses. Rasulullah is being scorned. He's being scolded. He's being lectured in these verses. While according to the school of thought of Ahlul Bayt, according to our imams and our scholars, the one that is being addressed by these verses is whom? Uthman ibn Affan, or a man from Bani Umayyah. A man from Bani Umayyah. Now this has been the setup throughout history. Sunni scholars believe that this is Rasulullah being addressed. Shi'i scholars believe that this is Uthman ibn Affan. And this is how it's been. However, there is one or two contemporary Shi'i scholars that believe this is not Uthman ibn Affan, but rather Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. And this created a controversy. And this brought back the discussion that who is the verse, who are these verses speaking about? Tonight, my dear brothers and sisters, in the minutes that we have with you at your service, we want to see, first of all, why do our Sunni brothers and sisters believe that this is Rasulullah? Why? What proof do they have? What evidence do they have? Two, what evidence and proof do Shi'i scholars have when they say that this is Uthman ibn Affan? Do they have something personal against Uthman? Or we have proof and evidence? Three, are there any Shi'i scholars that believe this is Rasulullah and not Uthman, as it has been ascribed to some? Is this true? Are there Shia scholars that believe that this is Rasulullah and not Uthman? And fourth, what is our humble opinion on this topic? Objectively, unbiasedly, by looking at the evidence, by looking at the proof, what is our opinion? According to the Quran itself and according to the narrations, with all the evidence and proof that we have, what is the conclusion that we arrive at? The person that is mentioned in this verse, عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى, is this Rasulullah or is this someone else? صَلَّى عَلَى مُحَمَّدُ وَعَلَى مُحَمَّدُ.
Allah, 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 Allah.
Keep in mind that we have been raised, we followers of Ahlul Bayt, we have been raised to believe, we grew up with this, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi has the perfect manners. No one has manners and akhlaq better than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. And the Quran testifies to this. The Quran says, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. You have high manners, you have the greatest manners. And he himself, Rasulullah, states that I was sent to perfect people's manners and akhlaq. إِنَّمَا بُعِثْ لِأُتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi has the best manners. Is it possible that Rasulullah, that was sent to perfect people's manners, that Allah tells us that he has the greatest of manners, is it possible that Rasulullah frowns at a blind man and turns away from a blind man and gives his attention to rich men and ignores the poor blind man? Is this the akhlaq of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Is this the Rasulullah that we have been raised to know? Or is it someone else? It's one of the companions of Rasulullah. It was him that frowned and turned away from the blind man. However, there were some people that tried to protect this companion. Protect him at the cost of whom? At the cost of Rasulullah. Instead of putting the blame on this companion, they said, you know what? Well, we can't change the verse. We can't change the words of the verse. So let's change the meaning of the verse. Instead of saying that it was revealed about Rasulullah, let's say that it was instead of saying that it was revealed about so-and-so, Uthman ibn Affan, let's say that it was revealed about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is a possibility as well. Or some might say, and there are some from our communities, from the Shi'i community, there are some that ascribe themselves to the Islamic seminary and are scholars. They say, you know, we Shi'a, we should not be too naive. Rasulullah is a man at the end of the day. He's a human. And human beings, they have emotions. Sometimes they get angry, they frown, they turn away, they get upset. The Prophet is a human being. At the end of the day, he's not supernatural. He's not a superhuman. He's a human being. So it's possible that Rasulullah could have frowned and turned away, just like any human being. Is this also a possibility or no? Let's see. Let's first off begin with the Sunni opinion on this verse. They believe that it was revealed regarding Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa sallam. Why? Let us see. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. The Sunni narration, they say, and this is in their books of tafsir, in the tafsir of Al-Fakhr al-Razi, Al-Qurtubi, tafsir al-Qurtubi, which is known as Al-Jami' al-Ahkam al-Quran, tafsir al-Zamakhshari, tafsir al-Kashaf, and others, very well-known Sunni scholars of tafsir. They mention this scenario, this story, as I will mention it now. They say that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sitting with the top leaders of Quraysh, Sanadidu Quraysh. He was sitting with them and he was having a discussion. He was trying to get them to convert to Islam. He was trying his best. They say this, طَمَعَ فِي إِسْلَامِهِمْ. He was very interested in getting them to convert. Why? Because these are powerful and rich men in Quraysh. If they were to convert to Islam, two things will happen. One, because of them, others will convert to Islam. They will get others to convert. Two, they will bring in cash. They will bring in money. So Rasulullah was looking, he was trying to get these men to convert to Islam. So number one, to increase his followers. And number two, to get money. These people will bring in money to support Islam. And he was in a deep conversation, trying his best to convert these people into Islam. Who were these men from Quraysh? Sunni scholars themselves, they disagree. Some say it was Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, the uncle of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's one. And this is the opinion of Sufyan al-Thawri. Others say it was Shaybah and Utbah and Ubay ibn Khalaf. Utbah, the father of Hind, the mother of Muawiyah. His brother, Shaybah, Ubay ibn Khalaf, these are well-known men from Bani Umayyah and from Quraysh. Rasulullah was trying his best to get them to convert. Others say it was Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, well-known figure, who had rejected Rasulullah, had called him a magician, had called him insane. Now Rasulullah was trying to get him to convert. Others say, and this is the opinion of Az-Zamakhshari, that this was Abu Jahl, the arch nemesis, the arch enemy of Rasulullah, and Shayban Utba, those who fought Rasulullah at Badr. Rasulullah was trying to get them to convert to Islam. He was trying his best. They give us a picture that Rasulullah was sitting with them. He was trying to appease them, trying his best to convert these men into Islam. In the middle of this conversation, all of a sudden, a blind man by the name of Abdullah ibn Maktum, one of the companions of Rasulullah, who was blind, he was a blind man, and he was poor. He wasn't so rich. He didn't own anything. He was an average person, poor guy. He comes into the conversation. And he interrupts Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, according to their opinion. This is all according to the Sunni opinion. Abdullah ibn Maktum, also known as Ibn Maktum, he comes in and he interjects and he interferes in the conversation, and he stops the conversation and he wants to ask Rasulullah a question. Rasulullah was very upset that this person is, he's interrupting. He's interrupting this very important conversation with Sanadidu Quraysh, the leaders of Quraysh. Now, why was he so upset? He was upset to the point that he frowned. He frowned at this blind man, Ibn Maktum. He frowned at him and he turned away. He looked to the other side. He ignored him. Why? Well, one, he was busy with something more important. This is what they say. I'm trying to explain what they said, and then we'll have our answer. So supposedly Rasulullah was having a very important conversation, something a lot more important than what Ibn Maktum wanted to ask about. His question wasn't very important. Something about wudu, something about salah. While Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was trying to get these men to convert to Islam with all the advantages that it would bring. So Rasulullah was upset. This is one possible reason why Rasulullah got upset. Two, perhaps because Ibn Maktum's question wasn't very important. He could have waited. It wasn't like it's an emergency that he had to interrupt Rasulullah. He could have waited 30 minutes, more, less. He could have waited until Rasulullah finished, then he could have interrupted. But he didn't. He interrupted. He couldn't wait, so Rasulullah frowned. Three, one possible reason is that interrupting a conversation, whether it's important or non-important, that's annoying. When you're having a conversation with your wife and your kids come and disturb you, they come and interrupt you, they come and ask, they want food, they want water, they want something, and you get annoyed. You're having a deep conversation with your wife, you haven't seen her all day, you just came back from work, and now your child interrupts. Or you're having a conversation with your friend and your wife interrupts. Or your husband interrupts. You're speaking on the phone with your girlfriend, the lady, obviously. You're talking about something very important, something serious. And then your husband, he's asking for toothpaste. Or he can't find the shampoo, or he can't find the car keys or something. That's very annoying. That's very annoying, especially because you want to go back to the conversation and you lose your train of thought. That's annoying. This is a reason. Another reason, and this is what they say, this is what the Sunni narration says, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was annoyed. One of the reasons why he was annoyed is that he's talking to these rich men from Quraysh, Sanadid Quraysh. powerful aristocrats, very rich, very important people. All of a sudden, this blind, poor person comes and interrupts, and he speaks to Rasulullah. And Rasulullah thought to himself, you know, I don't want this guy to come right now, because these men who I'm trying to convert, they're going to think that all of my followers are like him. All of my followers are blind, they're poor, they're low class, they're from the poor class, and these guys are going to be turned off. They're going to think that if Muhammad's followers are like him, then you know what? Forget it. Forget it. قال في نفسه. This is exactly what Al-Qurtubi mentions in his tafsir. قال في نفسه Rasulullah. He said to himself, يقول هؤلاء إنما أتباعه العميان والسفلة والعبيد. These men are going to think to themselves that all of my followers are blind, they're poor, and they're from the low class. So basically, Rasulullah was embarrassed of Ibn Maktum. He was embarrassed. He didn't want him to show up. He wanted him to stay away because he was on a mission, and he's embarrassing him. So what happened? Rasulullah frowns and he turns away and he's disturbed. He wants Ibn Maktum to go away. And what happens? Allah reveals these verses. عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى. He frowned and he looked away. And جَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى. When the blind man came to him. وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لَعَلَّهُ يَزَّكَّى. And how do you know? Apparently, according to the Sunni opinion, that Allah is addressing Rasulullah. He's telling him, Ya Rasulullah, how do you know? Perhaps this blind man will become righteous. أَوْ يَذَّكَّرُ فَتَنْفَعَهُ الذِّكْرَى. Or he will remember, and the remembrance will benefit him. أَمَّا مَنْ اسْتَغْنَى فَأَنْتَ لَهُ تَصَدَّى. As for the rich men of Quraysh, you give your attention to them. وَمَا عَلَيْكَ أَلَّا يَزَّكَّى. What's it to you if those rich men are guided or not guided? What's it to you? وَأَمَّا مَنْ جَاءَكَ يَسْعَى وَهُوَ يَخْشَى فَأَنْتَ عَنْهُ تَلَهَى. As for the one that comes to you, that comes and makes an effort to, who came to you, and he has fear of Allah, you ignore him? So supposedly, the verses are speaking about Rasulullah. Allah is lecturing Rasulullah, he's scolding him, he's scorning him for this misbehavior, for this lack of manners, for this arrogance towards this blind man, this poor man, by the name of Ibn Maktum. And they narrate that Rasulullah, whenever after this, after being lectured by Allah, whenever he would see Ibn Maktum, he would tell him, Marhaban. مَرْحَبًا بِمَنْ عَاتَبَنِي فِيهِ رَبِّي. Hello, or welcome to the person whom I was lectured because of by Allah. Allah lectured me because of you. Welcome, he would welcome him. And to make things up for him, to Ibn Maktum, whenever Rasulullah would leave Medina, he would let Ibn Maktum lead prayers in his place to make it up for him, to make him feel better. He would let Ibn Maktum lead prayers in his place. Now this is the Sunni opinion. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Now some Sunni scholars, when they see that this narration, it does what? It humiliates Rasulullah. This is an insult to Rasulullah. And they know that Rasulullah is above this. They know that this does not fit in well with the Rasulullah that they know and they grew up with. And the Rasulullah that the Quran speaks so highly of. They know this, there's something wrong. So what do? There's some apologists that try to, you know, make things better a little bit. How? They say, Allah is not lecturing Rasulullah. No. You know what Ibn Maktum did? It was bad. Because Ibn Umm Maktum interrupted Rasulullah. What he did was bad. Okay, well, if Ibn Umm Maktum did something bad, then why is Allah, why are the verses lecturing Rasulullah? They say, huh, because Allah didn't want all the poor people and maybe some of the blind people to feel bad and to feel humiliated, so Allah decided to lecture Rasulullah on this. Even though Ibn Umm Maktum, what he did was bad, he deserved it. He deserved being frowned upon. He deserved what he got. But Allah doesn't want poor people to feel bad, so he lectures Rasulullah. You see? This is one of their justifications. Another, they say that, yeah, what Rasulullah did wasn't bad. Even though he got lectured, but it wasn't bad, it doesn't contradict his akhlaq because he knew that Ibn Umm Maktum had strong faith, had strong iman, and he wouldn't be affected. Rasulullah knew that Ibn Umm Maktum will not be offended, so he frowned at him and he looked away. So it's okay. Ajib. Another justification that they mention, you know, when they see that, how could Rasulullah possibly do this? Frown at a man and turn away. They say, well, Ibn Umm Maktum is blind. And Rasulullah frowned at him. He's a blind man, he couldn't see, so what's the big deal? It's okay to frown at someone who's blind. Oh, I see. It's okay to frown at someone who's blind just because he can't see. It's okay to frown at him. I suppose it's okay to steal a blind man's money as well. If he can't see, you could steal his food. You could steal his money because he can't see. So that's fine. Obviously, these justifications are not acceptable. They don't make sense. And they're not compatible with the Rasulullah that we know. This is a Sunni opinion. Now, what is the Shi'i opinion? You've heard one side of the story. You've heard what the Sunni scholars have had to say about these verses, Abasa wa Tawalla. Now let's hear what Shi'i scholars have said about these verses. Salla ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Shi'i scholars, from the day of Sayyid al-Murtada, or even before, up till the present day, 99% of our scholars, maybe even more than 99%, 99.95% of our scholars, they say that these verses were not revealed about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rather, they were revealed about Uthman ibn Affan, or a man from Bani Umayyah. Now, our narrations, they tell us the following story. And this is in Tafsir al-Qummi, Tafsir Ali ibn Ibrahim al-Qummi. He says that Rasulullah was sitting with a group of his companions. Rasulullah was sitting with a group of his companions. There is no mention of Sanadid Quraysh, the powerful men of Quraysh, no. Rasulullah was sitting with a group of his companions, and among them was Uthman ibn Affan. He was also sitting. And Ibn Umm Maktum, Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum, he came in to this session of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Ibn Umm Maktum comes and sits next to whom? Uthman. Uthman, we'll talk about this later. We'll get to this, the personality of Uthman. Uthman, when he saw Ibn Umm Maktum, who was poor, who was blind, who was from, you know, who was not so fortunate. When he saw Ibn Umm Maktum came and sat next to him, Uthman frowned and looked away. How could this man, Ibn Umm Maktum, out of all the places he chooses and comes and sits next to me? Doesn't he know that I'm rich? Doesn't he know that I'm Uthman ibn Affan? I'm from Bani Umayyah. So he frowned and he looked away because a poor man came and sat next to him. And here the verses were brought down. عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى أَنْ جَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى. He frowned and he looked away when the blind man came to him, came and sat next to him. وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لَعَلَّهُ يَزَّكَّى Oh Uthman, how do you know? What do you know? Perhaps this person will come and benefit from Rasulullah. He will become righteous. He will learn. He will receive a remembrance. And he will benefit from that remembrance. أَمَّا مَنْ اسْتَغْنَى فَأَنْتَ لَهُ تَصَدَّى As for the rich men, your friends, you give them your attention. Well, when a poor man like Ibn Maktoum comes, you gather your clothing. You gather your clothes as if, you know, as if his poverty will... You'll pick up his poverty as if it's like an illness that you're afraid you will catch. So the verses come regarding Uthman ibn Affan. This is according to Tafsir al-Qumi. According to Tafsir Majma' al-Bayan by Sheikh al-Tabrasi. He says, رُوِيَ عَنَ الصَّادِقِ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ أَنَّهَا نَزَلَتْ فِي رَجُلٍ مِّن بَنِي أُمَيَّةٍ كَانَ عَنْدَ النَّبِيِّ فجاء ابن أم مكتوم فلما رآه تقذر منه وعبس في وجهه وجمع نفسه وأعرض بوجهه عنه. He says that Rasulullah was sitting with a group of people and a man from Bani Umayyah, Imam Sadiq alayhi salam. He says a man from Bani Umayyah, he doesn't tell us what his name is. And I will remark on this in a couple of minutes. A man from Bani Umayyah was sitting. Ibn Maktoum comes and sits next to that man from Bani Umayyah. That man from Bani Umayyah, you know, he was disgusted by that poor man, by the blind man. Maybe his clothing wasn't so perfect. And this man from Bani Umayyah, he's rich. So he gathered himself. He gathered his clothing. And he frowned and he looked away. He frowned and he looked away. And then, Shaykh al-Tabrasi in Majma' al-Bayan, he tells us more that when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, when he would see Ibn Maktoum, he would say, مرحباً مرحباً لا يعاتبني فيك ربي أبداً. He would welcome him and he would say, my Lord will never lecture me about you. You see the difference between the two traditions? Between the two narrations. The Sunni narration would say that Rasulullah would tell Ibn Maktoum that what? I welcome the one that Allah lectured me about. In this narration, the Prophet says, my Lord will never lecture me about you. Meaning what? Meaning that if some people assume that I was lectured about you, no, it's not me. لا يعاتبني فيك ربي. My Lord will not scold me or lecture me because of you. Now, Imam Sadiq alayhi salam in this narration, he says, رَجُلٌ مِّن بَنِي أُمَيَّةٍ Someone from Bani Umayyah. He doesn't say who. Most likely it's whom? It's whom? Uthman ibn Affan. Uthman ibn Affan is from Bani Umayyah. But why doesn't Imam Sadiq mention his name? Out of taqiyya. Out of taqiyya, Imam Sadiq, because we know that in some majalis, in some gatherings, Imam Sadiq, in the gatherings of Imam Sadiq, there were spies in the gatherings of Imam Sadiq. And this was at the time that Bani Umayyah, they were in power. So if Imam Sadiq were to bring the name of Uthman ibn Affan, who was very revered by Bani Umayyah, and there are spies in his gatherings, this would put him in trouble. Thus, most likely, I presume, this is my own personal analysis, that رَجُلٌ مِّن بَنِي أُمَيَّةٍ most likely is Uthman ibn Affan. And the Imam is practicing taqiyya. Notice the distortion in the narration. In the first narration, the Sunni narration, the Imam, the Prophet welcomes Ibn Maktoum, and he says, this is the one that Allah lectured me because of. In this narration, the Prophet says, my Lord will never lecture me because of you. You see the difference? صلى على محمد وعلى محمد. Now that we know the two opinions, and we saw the story, we saw the two scenarios, we saw the scenario that Sunni scholars gave us, the Sunni tradition, that this was Rasulullah that frowned and looked away, from Ibn Maktum. And we saw the Shi'i scenario, the scenario that the Ahlul Bayt gave us, that it wasn't Rasulullah, it was either a man from Bani Umayyah or Uthman ibn Affan. He frowned and he looked away from the blind man, the poor man, Ibn Maktum. Now we have two traditions, two narrations. Which one are we going to accept? Now we have to be objective. Let's not be biased. Just because this is a Shi'i tradition and that's a Sunni tradition, that's not an excuse. Let's be academic. Let's be objective. Let's be unbiased. Let's see which one we should choose. According to both schools of thought, Sunnis and Shi'i schools of thought, if there are contradicting narrations, if there are two conflicting narrations, conflicting traditions, which one should we choose? All schools of thought agree we should choose the hadith, the narration that conforms to the Quran. The one that is compatible with the Quran we choose, and the one that is not compatible with the Quran, the one that contradicts the Quran, we neglect, right? So let's come and see which opinion, which theory, which scenario is compatible with the Quran and which one contradicts the Quran. Let's choose the Sunni opinion, the one that says it was Rasulullah that frowned and looked away. Is this compatible with the Quran? Let's see. Does this tradition, does this narration, this hadith, does it not conflict and contradict the Quran? Number one, the Quran says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, wa innaka la'ala khuluqin azeem. Ya Rasulullah, you have great manners. You have high manners. You know, this is not coming from someone ordinary. This is not coming from someone ordinary. Let me give you an example. If I see someone playing basketball, right? And I think that he's fantastic. I tell him, you're a good basketball player. Is my testimony worth a lot? You know, it could be worth a lot to my family. To my family members, it might be worth a lot to my friends. But to ordinary people, who cares if I think someone is a good basketball player? Okay, how about another basketball player? Another basketball player sees a person playing basketball. He tells them, you know what? You're a good basketball player. You're good. How about this time? Is that a good testimony? Yes, because it's coming from a basketball player. How about if it comes from Michael Jordan? Michael Jordan, the best basketball player in history. If he sees a person and he says, you're a good basketball player. What do you think of this testimony? Is this good or not good? Obviously it's good. That person should put this testimony in a plaque and hang it up somewhere because it's coming from Michael Jordan. Now who's telling Rasulullah that you have good manners? This is not a normal person. This is not a human being. Allah, who has the best of all manners, is telling Rasulullah, وَأَنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. You see? This is a testimony coming from the one who has the best of all manners, Allah. And Rasulullah says regarding Allah, أَدَّبَنِي رَبِّي فَأَحْسَنَ تَأْدِيبِي. Allah disciplined me. Allah taught me manners. Allah, who is the greatest of all, is calling Rasulullah, is telling him, you have great manners. Allah is impressed with the manners of Rasulullah. وَأَنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. Now, Allah is telling him, وَأَنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. A person who has manners like this, عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى, frowns and turns away from a blind man. Is there no contradiction between this? If we say that this verse was revealed about Rasulullah, isn't there a contradiction with وَأَنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ? What do you say? Of course there's a contradiction. That means that the Quran contradicts itself. Allah contradicts himself in the Quran. Here he tells us, وَأَنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. And here he tells us, عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى. The Prophet frowned and turned away when a blind man came to him. That's a clear contradiction. Allah would never contradict himself. In another verse, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ. Out of the mercy of Allah, Ya Rasulullah, You softened for them. You softened for your people, for your companions, for these pagan Arab, for these pagans. وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. If you were harsh, if you had rough manners, they would have left you. They wouldn't have listened to you. So basically Allah is telling Rasulullah that you softened, you have good manners. You attracted people with your manners. And then Allah says, عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّىٰ أَنْ جَعَوْا الْعَمَىٰ. And He's talking about Rasulullah. This is clearly what? A contradiction. Here Allah says you softened for them, you have good manners, you attracted them with your manners. And then He says you're found to a blind man and He lectures him? Impossible. And another verse, Allah orders the Prophet to show humility and humbleness to the believers. وَخْفِضْ جَنَاحَكَ لِمَنِ اتَّبَعَكَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Allah says, lower your wings to those who follow you from the believers. Lower your wings. What does that mean? Lower your wings. Have you seen birds? Have you seen peacocks? No, peacocks, they have beautiful feathers, all colorful. When a peacock wants to show off, especially a male peacock and a female peacock, when a male peacock sees a female peacock, what does he do? He shows off his feathers. It's a sign of arrogance. He's showing off. But when no one's looking around, he lowers his wings and his feathers out of humility. Allah tells, and there's a lot of verses. For example, there's verses that speak to children regarding their parents. وَخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ. Lower your wings towards your parents, meaning show them humility, show them humbleness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders the Prophet to show humility and humbleness to the believers. If these verses, عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّىٰ, we're talking about Rasulullah, is this humility? Is this humbleness? This is what? This is arrogance. That means Rasulullah is disobeying Allah. That means Rasulullah committed a sin. That means Rasulullah is not a ma'soom, not infallible. Do you accept this? Do we accept this? I don't think even our Sunni brothers and sisters accept this. But they have to think. They have to look at other verses and compare and contrast. If you think that Rasulullah was the one that frowned and looked away, that means he's not even infallible. Let alone, you know, his akhlaq. He's not even infallible, because here Allah tells him that lower your wings to the believers. Show humility. And another verse, بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. The Prophet is all merciful to the believers. And another verse, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We sent you, Ya Rasulullah, as a mercy for mankind. What kind of mercy is this? That the Prophet frowns and he looks away. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. Thus clearly, when we compare the two opinions, when we compare the two theories, the Shi'i theory and the Sunni theory, the theory that says these verses were revealed regarding the Prophet, or the theory that says these verses were revealed regarding Uthman ibn Affan, it's a no-brainer. When we look at the Qur'an, we examine the Qur'an, if we were to think that these verses were revealed regarding the Prophet, we are contradicting the Qur'an itself. This contradicts the Qur'an. Furthermore, if we were to analyze the Sunni theory even more, the Sunni opinion even more, the Sunni narration stated that Rasulullah was very interested in the conversion of these men, Sanadidi Quraysh. He was interested. He was very, you know, interested in their conversion. He was trying his best to convert them. Why? Because they'll bring in a lot of followers and they'll bring in a lot of money. Is this the Rasulullah that we know? That's looking for a lot of followers, a big following? No, and he's looking for money as well. Rasulullah had all the money that he wanted. Rasulullah was not in need of money. Rasulullah had the money of Khadija alayhi salam. She had left him with all of her wealth. Rasulullah was not in need of their wealth. This is not the Rasulullah that we know. Second, Rasulullah gave all his attention to these rich mushrikeen, and I wish they were believers. They were mushrikeen, they were idol worshippers, and he ignores a believer. This is not part of the akhlaq of Rasulullah. Rasulullah would give his attention equally to all of his followers. His followers, his sahaba, among his akhlaq was that he would give his attention equally. If he were to speak, he would look at one of the sahaba and then he would look at the other one equally. Meaning if he gave his attention to one of the sahaba, for example, a minute, he would give his attention to the other sahaba, a minute here, without any discrimination. This is the Rasulullah that we know. And this is among believers. Now here Rasulullah gives his attention to non-believers, to mushrikeen, to idol worshippers, and he ignores a believer, a mu'min. Would this happen? That's two. Three, they say that Rasulullah thought to himself that these people are going to think all of my followers are blind and poor and from the low class. So he was ashamed. He was embarrassed of Ibn Maktum. He wanted to get rid of him because he was embarrassed of him. Is this the Rasulullah that we know? He's ashamed of a blind man, of a poor man. He didn't want them to think that his followers are poor. First of all, how do they know what was Rasulullah thinking in his mind? The narrator, how does he know what was Rasulullah thinking? Was he inside Rasulullah's heart and mind to know what the Prophet was thinking? Second, Rasulullah had so many poor followers. In fact, most of his followers were poor. They were from the low class. Rasulullah had designated a corner in his masjid called As-Suffa for all the poor people that did not own homes. He had a corner for them, and it still exists. Shockingly, surprisingly, the Saudis have not destroyed the Suffa inside Al-Masjid al-Nabawi. It exists till today. Rasulullah would sit with them. He would go and eat with them. He would go and have lunch or dinner with these poor people. Rasulullah was never ashamed of having poor followers or ashamed of sitting with them. They say that this story does not contradict the infallibility of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa sallam. Yes, perhaps it does not contradict his infallibility, but it contradicts his akhlaq. You know, when you read these books of tafsir by Sunni scholars, they tell you that at the end of the day, it does not conflict with the infallibility of Rasulullah. Let's say it does not conflict with the infallibility of Rasulullah. What about his akhlaq? Does it conflict with the akhlaq of Rasulullah? Rasulullah, who had the best of akhlaq with his enemies, let alone his followers. The story of the Jewish lady, his neighbor, who would bring out trash and would put it in front of the house of Rasulullah every day. Rasulullah never heard her, never yelled at her, never insulted her. On the contrary, when she fell ill, one day Rasulullah comes out of his house and he sees that there's no trash. He says, why isn't there trash? They told him that lady, the Jewish lady, she's ill. She's sleeping at her house. He said, let's go and visit her. He went and he visited her. Rasulullah, who had the best of akhlaq with his sahaba, some of them were rough, some of them were rigid, some of them had tough akhlaq. Ya Rasulullah, had the best of manners. They would come inside his house and they would shout. They would call him by his name, Ya Muhammad. And they would say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. They would go inside his house without asking for permission. Yeah, Rasulullah did not tell them, don't come. Allah told them not to come. There's a verse that was revealed. لا تدخلوا بيوت النبي حتى يؤذن لكم. Do not enter the Prophet's house unless you've been given permission. Because Rasulullah was too embarrassed to tell them, don't enter my house. This was the akhlaq of Rasulullah. Rasulullah had 9 wives. Each one of them had her own personality, had her own akhlaq. Especially one of them, you all know, She had her own akhlaq. Ya Rasulullah put up with her akhlaq. He put up with her stubbornness. Rasulullah was known for his great akhlaq. Here all of a sudden he frowns and he turns away. On the contrary, let's look at the akhlaq of Uthman ibn Affan. Let's see that he frowned and turned away. It's more compatible with the akhlaq of Rasulullah or the akhlaq of Uthman ibn Affan. When we read the biography of Uthman ibn Affan, we see that with Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, the famous companion of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he disagreed with him. He beat Abdullah ibn Mas'ud to the point that his ribs were broken. And if you want a Sunni source, Murawwij al-Dhahab, I apologize. Ansab al-Ashraf, Ansab al-Ashraf lil-Baladhuri. Sunni scholar, a Sunni source. He mentions that Uthman ibn Affan, he beat Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, the famous Sahabi of Rasulullah, to the point that he broke his ribs. Is this akhlaq? Is this manners? With Ammar ibn Yasir, very well known Sahabi of Rasulullah, who Rasulullah loved. In fact, he's among those who Rasulullah told him his place in paradise. صَبْرًا يَا آلَ يَاسِرْ فَإِنَّ مَوْعَدُكُمُ الْجَنَّةِ. When his parents died, Yasir and Sumayya, Rasulullah, he eulogized them, and he told Ammar, صَبْرًا يَا آلَ يَاسِرْ, have patience, your place is in paradise. Ammar ibn Yasir was abused, physically abused by Uthman ibn Affan numerous times. At times he was pushed, at other times he was beaten. Once Ammar ibn Yasir objected to Uthman. He told him that, you know, some of the things that you're doing are not Islamic. When Uthman ibn Affan was in office, when he was the Khalifa, Ammar was brave. He objected to him. He had Uthman told his people, grab Ammar, pull his hands and his feet with ropes, and then he came and he beat Uthman, he beat Ammar severely until Ammar had hernia. He had a hernia because of the beating that he received at the order of Uthman ibn Affan. Is this akhlaq? Are these manners? And again, this will be found in Ansab al-Ashraf by al-Baladhuri, who's a Sunni scholar. I'm not mentioning any Shi'i sources. Was he not the one, Uthman ibn Affan, was he not the one that sent Abu Dhar al-Ghifari into exile? He sent him to al-Rabadha, the famous Sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the one who always spoke the truth, he never lied, to the point that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam stated regarding Abu Dhar, he said, "Ma adallat al-khadra wa la aqallat al-ghabra ala dhi lahjatin asdaq min Abi Dhar." That the sun has not risen on someone who is more honest and truth speaking than Abu Dhar. He sends him to al-Rabadha. And Abu Dhar was ill. He dies by himself. He needed medical attention. He dies. And when Ammar objected to Uthman ibn Affan for sending Abu Dhar to al-Rabadha, Ammar told him, Uthman told Ammar that I'll send you as well. Imam Ali alayhi salam came and objected to Uthman. He told him, you know what? You are also deserving of being sent into exile. Yeah. Uthman tells Imam Ali alayhi salam. He threatens him by sending him into exile. In fact, today I was doing some research, even though this lecture was prepared a long time ago. Today I was reading about the akhlaq of Uthman. At many times I found him to curse at some of the Sahaba, use foul language with some of the most prominent Sahabi. With Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, with Ammar ibn Yasir. He uses some of the dirtiest language with Ammar ibn Yasir. Is this akhlaq? Read Ansab al-Ashraf by al-Baladhuri. and see some of the akhlaq of Uthman ibn Affan. Was he not the one that beat his wife, Kulthum, the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi? If Kulthum is the daughter, this is obviously a debate. That Rasulullah, did he only have Fatima al-Zahra as his daughter? Or he had three other daughters, Zainab, Kulthum, and Ruqayya? Or were they the daughters of the sister of Khadija, yet were raised at the house of Rasulullah? Anyway, there's a debate. There are some that say they were the daughters of Rasulullah. Some say that Kulthum was the daughter of Rasulullah. Some historians say. He beat Kulthum, the daughter of Rasulullah, to the point that after 3 days she died. She died. And this is also in Ansab al-Ashraf by al-Baladhuri. The one who beats the daughter of Rasulullah to the point that he killed her. And when he killed her, when she died, Rasulullah cursed him. He said, قَتَلَهَا قَتَلَهُ اللَّهُ. He killed her, may Allah kill him. This is the akhlaq of this man. Now, you have a verse, عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى أَنْ جَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى. He frowned and turned away when a blind man came to him. Now you have two options. To say this was Rasulullah, or this was Uthman ibn Affan, you make that choice. Who do you say? Have some, be objective. Let's be objective. And I wish that our Sunni brothers and sisters, who inshallah hopefully will listen to this, I hope they will be objective and they decide that this verse, he frowned and he looked away, it's more befitting of Rasulullah, or it's more befitting of Uthman ibn Affan. They say that this the verses are speaking to Rasulullah. عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى أَنْ جَاءَهُ الْأَعْمَى وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لَعَلَّهُ يَزَّكَّى. The verses are speaking. And in the Quran, Allah only speaks to Rasulullah. And in these verses, first it's speaking in third person, then it turns into first person. وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ. And how do you know? Perhaps he becomes righteous. They say, see, it's obviously the verses are addressing Rasulullah, because in the Quran, Allah only addresses Rasulullah. First of all, who told you that? Who told you that Allah only addresses Rasulullah? We see in many cases in the Quran, Allah addresses others. Allah addresses Fir'aun in the Quran. الْآنَ وَقَدْ عَصَيْتَ قَبْلِ وَكُنْتَ مِنَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. Allah addresses Fir'aun. فَالْيَوْمَ نُنَجِّيكَ بِبَدَنِكَ. Today we preserve your body. Allah speaks to Fir'aun. Allah speaks, addresses Shaytan in the Quran. فَخْرُجْ فَإِنَّكَ مِنَ الصَّاغِرِينَ. Leave paradise. Leave. Allah addresses Shaytan. وَشَارِكْهُمْ فِي الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَوْلَادِ. And be their partners. Allah speaks to Shaytan. Be their partners and in their children and in their wealth. So the same way that Allah addresses the Prophet in the Quran, Allah addresses others in the Quran. That's not sufficient proof. Now, are there Shi'i scholars that say these verses were revealed regarding Rasulullah? From the time of Sayyid al-Murtada up till the present, all of our scholars said that this was not Rasulullah. This is Uthman. Yes, maybe one or two or three scholars. Two or three contemporary scholars, they believe that it's Rasulullah and not Uthman. But the vast majority of our scholars, there's an ijma', there's a consensus among our scholars, they believe that it's Uthman. Yes, some of our scholars, they said that hypothetically speaking, if it was Rasulullah, it does not contradict his infallibility. They say, see? They said, it does not contradict his infallibility. They said, hypothetically speaking. They didn't say, we believe this is Rasulullah. They said, hypothetically speaking, if it's Rasulullah, it doesn't contradict his asma, his infallibility. That's not his opinion. Finally, I conclude, my dear brothers and sisters, Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. You know, when we have debates with our Sunni brothers and sisters regarding these verses, عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى, when you tell them that these verses were revealed regarding Uthman, they get very offended. They get very offended. You say, you Shia, you like to insult the Sahaba. You Shia, you like to insult Uthman. You have no love for Uthman. You want to insult him. Oh, I see. So if we ascribe these verses to Uthman, it's an insult. But if we ascribe them to Rasulullah, it's not an insult. It's not an insult. You get offended when we say this is Uthman, but you don't get offended when you say this is Rasulullah. I wish that you would love Rasulullah as much as you love Uthman ibn Affan. That's all I say. I wish that you would love him, Rasulullah, as much as you love Uthman. They are willing to humiliate and insult Rasulullah just to protect some individuals. Is this fair? They narrate that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam one day was sitting with a group of his Sahaba, and his legs were extended, and his clothing was away, his thighs were showing. Imagine. They say Rasulullah's thigh, his thigh was showing, his leg and his thigh was showing to the Sahaba. Abu Bakr came in, Rasulullah remained sitting. Umar came in, Rasulullah remained sitting. Uthman came in, immediately Rasulullah got up and he covered his thigh and he covered his legs. They told him, why, ya Rasulullah? He said, because this is Uthman. تَسْتَحِي مِنْهُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ The angels are embarrassed of Uthman. You don't want me to be shy and embarrassed of Uthman? They denigrate, they degrade Rasulullah to this degree only to bring honor and respect for whom? For Uthman. This is a tragedy, wallahi al-azim. This is a tragedy. That some Muslims are willing to disrespect, and they say, don't disrespect the Sahaba. You're disrespecting Rasulullah, and you're worried about disrespect for the Sahaba? For you, it's okay to disrespect Rasulullah and say that Rasulullah frowned and he turned away, but not the Sahaba? And you're willing to distort the meanings of the verses? Shame. It's a shame. Uthman, wa ma adraka ma Uthman. Who brought Muawiyah to power? Who brought Yazid to power? Who was the first among Bani Umayyah to come to power? When Uthman came, he ruled for 12 years. He brought Bani Umayyah. Bani Umayyah were kicked out by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He brought Marwan ibn al-Hakam. He gave him land. He gave him power. He brought Abu Sufyan. He brought Muawiyah. And the one responsible for Yazid was Uthman. He brought them. He brought his family members to power. Thus, whether they like it or not, one of those who had a hand in the tragedy of Karbala and whose hands were stained by the blood of Imam Hussein was Uthman. Because otherwise, Bani Umayyah would not have come to power. La ilaha illallah.